This is World News Tonight with Peter Jennings.
Good evening. We begin tonight with the president, home from his trip overseas, pleased with what he's seen in person, and confident, so he says, that the American vision of the future will be realized. What the president says he senses is the dawning of a new age behind the Iron Curtain, and that is precisely what he's been encouraging everywhere he's been. And so he's home, and so's our White House correspondent, Brit Hume.
The president, who had once been criticized for failing to see the opportunity for change in the age of Mikhail Gorbachev, returned to the White House after his second trip to Europe in 3 months, proclaiming a new era there.
I found an enormous amount of excitement. Excitement at the times in which we are living and the possibilities they offer to end the division of Europe, to make that continent truly whole and free.
Earlier on the long flight home, he disclosed there had been spirited discussion bordering on argument with his Dutch host this morning about the cost of mutual defense.
There's a strong sentiment among some of the party people there for the United States to pick up the check for everything.
But generally, the president said he found European leaders willing to assume a greater share.
I think people realize that for many years we've been carrying a very significant defense burden for the free world, and they understand not rolling in money when it's our federal deficit.
Even before he landed, domestic matters caught up with him in the form of questions about a new book quoting Vice President Quayle's campaign handlers, descriptions of Quayle as childlike and inept.
The man is serious and he's doing a first-class job, but what troubled me about it, I found those quotations personally offensive because that's the ugly side of politics.
The Quayle flap will likely blow over, but the president obviously hopes that the impact of his trip will not, and in particular, that his two visits behind the Iron Curtain will add momentum to the very change there he was once accused of not recognizing. Brit Hume, ABC News, the White House.
Well, last week when he was in Poland, there was no Polish president for Mr. Bush to see in something of a political crisis. There may be a president tomorrow. The Communist Party leader Wojciech Jaruzelski said today that he would be a candidate for president after all when the new Polish legislature meets to elect a president tomorrow morning. ABC's Jerry King is in Warsaw tonight.
Jaruzelski apparently feels he's got what he's been waiting for, the full support of this group, his own coalition partners of communists, peasants, and social democrats, representing a majority of the newly elected National Assembly. No one here has seen evidence of it, but the man himself told Polish television it was widespread public support that had forced him to change his mind, and help from abroad, according to the Communist Party's spokesman.
It seems to me that a lot of political leaders in the East and the West express the view that Jaruzelski should to be the president.
The main push from outside may have come from George Bush, who last week made the general look like someone he could do business with.
I salute General Jaruzelski for his leadership and his extraordinary hospitality to me.
Solidarity members do not share that admiration. Today, they debated only two courses of action, vote against Jaruzelski or simply abstain. But they realize they cannot stop the general. With or without solidarity support, it seems clear Jaruzelski will be elected president tomorrow. And then the two sides will have to join forces to try to clean up Poland's economic and political chaos. Jerry King, ABC News, Warsaw.
On almost any other day, all the political maneuvering in Poland would have attracted considerable interest in the Soviet Union. Today, the Soviets were more than occupied with their own problems. The coal miners' strike in Siberia has now spread to the coal fields of the Ukraine, a threat to the Soviet economy and a deepening political challenge to the Soviet leadership in Moscow. Here's ABC's Rick Indifferth.
Tonight's report on Soviet television made it clear how far the strike has spread. Yesterday, workers in the Ukraine had shut down 8 mines. Today, that number is 30. Strike committees are being formed. Demands for better working and living conditions are being made. In the Kuzbass region of western Siberia, where the strike began 8 days ago, negotiations between workers and high-ranking officials from Moscow are at an impasse. This striker complained, "The government is offering only half measures, not what we expected." A member of the Supreme Soviet replied, "It's impossible to meet all their demands. The 70% increase in pensions they're asking for is simply not possible. The government doesn't have the money." It's estimated that the two coal fields in western Siberia and the Ukraine produce half the nation's coal. Since the strike began, more than 1 million tons have been lost. The government has warned that major sectors of Soviet industry, including steel mills and power stations, may have to be shut down. The strike presents Mikhail Gorbachev with a challenge and an opportunity. Some observers feel he could use it to demonstrate the need for economic reform.
If perestroika is going to mean anything at all, if it's going to succeed, it means that people have to be shaken up.
But if the strike continues and if the already ailing Soviet economy suffers heavy losses, then that argument may be turned against the Soviet leader, with critics saying his reforms are going too far. Rick and DeFirth, ABC News, Moscow.
Mr. Gorbachev has more ethnic tension to worry about today. The Kremlin has declared a state of emergency and curfew in the Abkhazian region of the Republic of Georgia. At least 16 people have been killed. Stores and factories in the area are reported to be closed. And military aircraft had to be used to evacuate thousands of tourists from the Black Sea resort of Suhumi. The Soviet Union and the United States have reached agreement today on a rough outline for a treaty to ban chemical weapons. The agreement calls for the destruction of existing chemical weapons stockpiles over a 10-year period. The trouble is it would go into effect only if all those other countries, including those who may think of such weapons as the poor man's nuclear bomb, honor the agreements as well. In a moment, the government wants to know why prescription drug prices are getting as high as they are. And later in the broadcast, children who need a home, the orphan.